Benefits and spiritual illuminations of the month, and so come here with lots of energy and himma and aspiration. So welcome to our first of our four sessions in Ramadan, inshallah. On an amazing scholar, selections from a book by an amazing scholar, Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah. This great 6th century Hijri scholar from Iraq is maybe not as well known as he should be. People often are confusing with the student Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, but this is a scholar who was centuries before him. And his fascinating work, Sogan Carter, the capturing of thoughts. And so this is a passage he wrote late in his life, where he reflected on certain aspects of life. It's very scattered in terms of subject matter, but if you're able to maybe make an index of it, then you can see that there are common threads in it. What I've tried to do is bring together the common threads scattered from around the book. So. When the Sheikh Sayyid al-Hassan al-Nadwi wrote his Rijal al-Fiqh wa Da'wa fil Islam, he mentioned Ibn al-Jawzi in the first volume. He called him a striking example of a preacher, reformer, and renegade of the faith, Mujahid. He was the most reputed, renowned, and profound scholar of his time, and a prolific author of voluminous books on exegesis of the Quran, tafsir, traditions, hadith, history, tarikh, and literary Christendom. Now, although this man lived almost 1,000 years ago, we see his words still being pored over and considered and deliberated over by ulama and scholars and lay people alike. And it is God who makes the names of these great past scholars known and maintained in the living memory of the Ummah. Yet when we delve into the biographies of the most popular scholars, and in the case of the Sayyid Ibn al-Jawzi, we can see perhaps the reason for his continued legacy, and that it is his deepest commitment and mastery of God's religion, primarily through their absolute immersion in the remembrance and worship of Allah, and then through their dedication to explaining the principles of the religion. People sense both the personal commitment and the scholarly mastery of these sorts of scholars, and so that's why you have people still turning to them for religious guidance when they want to understand their religion. Now, his father died when he was very young, and his mother sent him to study with a reputable traditionist of the time, Ibn Nasir, whereby he memorized the Quran and traditions. He was committed to study from a very young age, preferring studies and memorizing to playing as normal children did along the river. In his later life, he was committed to the recitation of the Quran, completing it once a week, as mentioned by his grandson, Abu Mudaffar, and he was dedicated to prayer and piety. Whilst he was committed to producing great scholarly works, he was also known to be a moving and skillful orator, someone who could give speeches by the permission of the kings in Baghdad. His sermons were attended by caliphs, kings, and chiefs of state, as well as by the general public. It is said that 20,000 Jews and Christians converted through him, and over 100,000 people would repent and pledge to lead a life of virtue at his hands. He wrote numerous works which are directed at correcting the actions and spiritual ills of the rulers, societal administrators, regular people, scholars, and those who sought to commit to Islamic spirituality. in terms of his main scholarly works that are of interest to us in this regard, you have firstly his Minhaj al-Qasidin, which was an abridgment of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali al-Ihya, and it sought to correct what he saw as the mistakes in the original work, but also to emphasize the importance and manners, both inner and outer, the zahir and the batin, of Islamic worship, public dealings, so you've got ibadat, mu'amalat, and matters of spirituality, of ihsan, or matters of the heart. This work was further abridged by Ibn Qudam al-Makhdasi. Also, there's an earlier work of his entitled Bahar al-Dumur, okay, the Sea of Weeping, which shows his early acquaintance with Islamic spirituality, because he wrote this when he was younger. But he would later moderate it against the excesses he saw in Islamic spirituality, even if they were from great masters like Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah. Secondly, to assist in cultivating a wholesome religious disposition, he compiled essentially an abridgment of Abu Nu'aym, Abu Nu'aym's Hilyat al-Awliya, and entitled it the Sifat al-Safwa. And again, as he did with Ghazali, he tried to expunge from Abu Nu'aym's work aspects which he saw were not in conformity with the correct Islamic practice and doctrine, whilst recounting the lives of previous righteous Muslims like Hassan al-Basri, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, Sufyan al-Thawri, Ibrahim ibn Adham, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ma'ruf al-Kharki, and others. Then thirdly, he wrote his extensive Talbis Iblis, The Deception of Shaitan, as a critique of practices and beliefs in the Muslim community, whether by state authorities or people trying to lead a pious religious life. Fourthly, he compiled a work called Al-Mawdu'at on the fabricated hadith. And although he took what Nadhif and others have said was a rather extreme position in the book, there's still benefit to be gained from his insights on it. And he was also criticized for, on the one hand, talking about fabricated hadith, but at the same time, in his own sermons, being full of them. And so sometimes, even in Sayyid al-Khatir, you'll find that he narrates very weak hadith in the course of his discourses. He also spoke about the attributes of Allah in two books which have come down to us, Kitab al-Khabar al-Sifat and Dafa Shubah al-Tashbih, in which he criticized fellow Hanbalis for he saw them interpreting literally certain hadith regarding Allah's attributes in an incorrect manner, according to Ibn al-Jawzi, and even criticizing Ibn Abdul Barr in this regard in Sayyid al-Khatir. But Ibn al-Jawzi, as outlined in the creed, the Aqidah section of Manaqib al-Imam Ahmad, he believed that Ahmad simply narrated such narrations and did not comment on them or explain them. He was very much a Hanbali and opposed to speculative or rational theology, Ibn al-Kalam, which he took from Imam Ahmad. And so in his Sayyid al-Khatir, he shows his belief that the masses should content themselves with a simple theology, because here we're talking about the masses of the heart, and the foundations of the heart, or the foundations of Islamic practice, are based on having a sound faith and a sound belief, Iman and Aqidah. And so in Sayyid al-Khatir, he emphasizes that the masses should content themselves with a simple theology, just simply remaining content with the arkan of Iman, as mentioned in the Hadith of Jibreel. So essentially believing in Allah, the messengers, the books, the angels, the last day and destiny, and not dwelling into controversies. Sixthly, he also wrote a very acclaimed tafsir of the entire Quran called Azad al-Masir, as well as a lengthy work on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Al-Wafa. And I hope that selections of these two books in particular will be made more readily available for the English speaking public. Seventh, he was also very committed to the legal school of Imam Ahmad. In his Manaqib al-Imam Ahmad, he has selections outlining why Ahmad was the best jurist in his opinion, having mastered the Quran, Arabic, analogy, qiyas, knowing more hadith than Malik, and I say that as a Maliki myself, and how Shafi'i would turn to Ahmad about narrations. And then eighth, he would write an interesting treatise on the virtues of black Africans called Tanwir al-Ghabash, Bifadal al-Sudan wal-Habash, Illuminating the Darkness. And he wrote this in order to uplift companions or people in the community that he saw from the black African continent who faced unjust racism. And so he wanted to emphasize to them and us that virtue in God's sight is through good deeds and not one's appearance. And then ninth, he wrote many more works, which he numbered at 2,000. A fair number of them, including some of the aforementioned, have been translated into English in both translations by Dar Arkam and Dar Sunnah in Berlin. So we see that this selection that we're going to look at, and also his general body of work, very much speaks to a modern audience. He talks about the excesses of Islamic spirituality, he talks about the excesses of rulers, he talks about excesses in terms of theology, as well as talking about racism at a time over 1,000 years ago. So you see how his relevance remains even to our time. And so if we want to try and look at this work thematically, because as I said, it's all scattered around. And so he begins, well, the one I want to begin with actually, it's actually in the middle of the book, but he talks about how guidance is simply from Allah. So he says, rahimahullah, what is chapter 255, essentially, if you want to pick it up later. He says, hidayah, guidance is from Allah. I contemplated the cause of people's guidance and their awakening from heedless, the ghafla. I came to realize the main cause behind it is such people chosen by Allah Ta'ala. It is, as was said, when Allah wants you to do a matter, He prepares you for it. Awakening can sometimes happen by having a mere thought. One's intellect, aql, necessitates to consider, leading him to realize his existence, and thereby concluding his existence necessitates having a creator. So Allah demands from him the fulfillment of his rights upon him, and thankfulness, shukr, for his graces, ni'am. He warned him with his punishment, iqab, which cannot be due to an apparent reason. This is similar to the case of the people of the cave, ashab al-kahf, where Allah says, when they stood up and said, our Lord is the Lord of the heavens and the earth. The books of Tafsir state, each one of them found in his heart a moment of awakening that made them believe that such creation must have a creator. Hence their inner selves ignited further due to the fueled fire of their cautiousness, wow, which made each one depart to the desert where all of them met without any prior arrangement. They asked each other about the reason that made them leave for the desert, and their answers were truthful. And the Josie then continues, in some cases, Allah uses some people to create such apparent causes, like initiating intellectual thinking and contemplation, fiqh. Thus, some people either awaken due to a sermon they heard or a lesson they witnessed that makes this apparent cause jolt the inner thought of the heart. The awakened are then divided into those whose desires overcome them, and so their nature returns them to the desires they are accustomed, making them deviate again, causing them not to benefit from such an awakening. In fact, this awakening establishes the proof against them on the day of judgment. And there are those who strive and stand in the middle between their desires that encourage them to follow worldly pleasures and their sensibility that encourage them to fear Allah. Some of them strive over a longer period but eventually deviate back to evil and their lives come to such an evil end, while others manage to overcome their desires once and fail to do so again after some time. But eventually their wounds caused by such struggles do not cause their death. Other people yet still manage to subdue their enemy and imprison him, making such an enemy stand helpless without weapon, but casting whispers to them. From among the elite, the khawas, are people whose hearts never fall asleep after their awakening, and so they never stop since embarking on the journey to Allah. This is because their endeavors and goals are aimed high. Each time they reach a higher rank, they realize more of their shortcomings and pitfalls. So even in this, we remember our Prophet ﷺ, how he would constantly make istighfar, despite having everything forgiven from him and being perfect, being ma'asum, but still he would return to Allah. Why? Because at every single time when he was being raised in spiritual rank, just having that humility and tawbah for the previous rank. But imagine our case, where we actually have mistakes and things. Each time they reach a higher rank, they realize more of their shortcomings and pitfalls. Therefore, they seek forgiveness. On the other hand, some of them may require striving, either due to the lowliness of what their nature may call for, though it does not affect them, or either due to the honour of what they endeavour to achieve, so they do not mind the hardship caused by it. You should know that the way to Allah cannot be walked using feet, but rather using hearts, and that the sudden impulse desires of hearts are bandits and thieves, while the road you embark on is like a dark night. Yet the eye of the one whom Allah guides is like the eyesight of the horse. Thereby he is able to see in the dark just as clear as it can see in the daytime. And sincerity, ikhlas, while embarking on the road is a beacon that directs to the right direction. Only those with insincere intentions will stumble in their walk, and those who refuse to be sincere are those whom Allah does not select for guidance, and there is no power and strength except with Allah. So you see how the striving towards Allah is something which is rooted in the heart. And ikhlas is something that will propel you on that path. But it requires striving, and there will be ups and there will be downs. But in order to reach the goal, you have to keep walking the path. And that's the encouragement that Ibn al-Jawzi encourages here. He then talks about the causes of being led astray. And he says, rahimahullah, I contemplated mankind and realized that their condition is so unbelievable. Such a case is that of a person who listens to a sermon and he is reminded of the hereafter. Although he believes the truthfulness of all that he heard, and he cries for his shortcomings and from failing in his duties, and so decides to endeavor to catch up with what he missed and overlooked, yet he fails to comply with what he intended to do. So the person who comes to the sermon, they're all inspired by it, but as soon as they leave, they return back to their old ways. If someone said to him, do you doubt any of what you are promised in the hereafter? His answer will be no, by Allah. I do not have any doubt. Then when he is advised to perform good deeds, he intends to do so, but then he does not do them. In fact, he may later incline to a forbidden pleasure, love the muharrama, of which he is aware is impermissible. This fact can be found in the story of the three people who remained behind in Medina and did not join the army in the Battle of Tabuk, and who had no valid excuse, though they were aware of the severity of such an act. The same is the case of every sinner, a heedless person. However, when I thought of the reason of those whom I assume to have a sound belief, i'tiqad sahih, yet their deeds are lacking and not as they should be, I came to realize three reasons cause people to be in such a condition. One, thinking of their current desires, hawa, which prevent them from thinking, fiqh, of the consequences of abiding to such desires. Two, delaying repentance, because if the intellect of people prevailed, it would have been made people aware of the harm of delaying repentance, because death may come all of a sudden before a person repents. I wonder at mankind who believe their soul may be taken in a period less than 1 hour, but are still not being resolute and endeared to work for such a moment. It is one's desire that makes a person think he will live a long life. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said, pray as if it is your last prayer. Hadith in Ibn Majah, which is a leak. And this is the cure for such illnesses, because he who believes he will not live long enough to witness the next prayer, salah, he will endeavor hard. Three, hoping for Allah's mercy. Hence, sinners often say, my Lord is the most merciful, Rabbi Rahim, but they seem to forget that his punishment is severe, shadid al-iqab. In fact, sinners should understand that his mercy, rahmah, neither entails softness nor weakness. Otherwise, he would not have created pain or decreed children to suffer sometimes. And also, he should remember that Allah's punishment was severe, for his decree that he who steals as low as 5 dirhams is to receive the hadith. This understanding should make them achieve more and work harder. And I ask Allah to grant us determination that makes us resolute in our affairs. Ameen. He then goes on in a number of places in the Sayyid on the importance of submission, taslim. And so he talks about submitting to God's wisdom as a spiritual virtue very often. says, I have seen many foolish people. Venting anger towards their destiny. Some of them developed a weaker faith by objecting to destiny. Some of them turned away from Islam in disbelief because of believing that destiny is foolish play. They say, what use is it for a creator who is in no need of harming us to create people, then have them disintegrate after death? I responded to some of those who talked about this. I'm willing to discuss this issue with you only if you are present-minded. If you talk without contemplation and fairness, then talking to you is a wasteful exercise. Woe to you. Bring your intellect and listen to what I have to say. It has been established that Allah is the owner and Malik, and that the owner has the right to control what he owns however he wishes. It has also been established that Allah is all-wise and Hakim, and someone who is wise never acts in vain. Yet I know that you are not comfortable admitting that Allah is all-wise. He says, I heard Janus say, I am not sure that Allah is wise or not. He said so because he noticed how things are erected then taken apart in this world. He compared Allah to his creation. For to us tearing something apart after erecting it is meaningless. We respond, how is it that you have determined that taking something apart after erecting it is unwise? Was not it through your intellect that was subsequently given to you by the Creator? How then would he grant you perfect intellect yet be deprived of it himself? In fact, this was the same problem that Iblis confronted. He put down Allah's wisdom, hikmah, using his own intellect, aqal. Had he contemplated, tafakkur, upon the realization that the creator of his intellect is the most wise, it is by his wisdom that he created intellects. If a fair person thinks about this, he will no longer have any doubt. Allah alluded to this when saying, or is it that he has females and you have the males? In Surah Al-Tur. So the only thing we can do is admit our deficiency and say, this is the act of the wise, knowledgeable one, and we do not understand the wisdom behind it. Prophet Musa, alayhi salam, did not realize the wisdom behind defecting the ship and killing the young boy, yet when al-Khidr explained them to him, he submitted. So let us see that our creator, like Musa, was with al-Khidr. Do we not see how nicely prepared food is eaten before it turns into that which we know? We do not object to such things because we understand their overall benefit. So why cannot Allah's actions have a hidden benefit as well that we are unaware of? The most ignorant of ignorant people is a slave who seeks to know the secrets of his master. He must surrender to have taslim, not object the iqtirar. In fact, had the only objective maqsood of the occurrence of strange things been to test our submission to Allah's will, it would have been enough. I have contemplated about the objective of death. Had there been no death, people would think they had no creator. We do not see Allah, yet after death the soul will realize so many new things. After the soul returns, it will be ready to be near Allah in paradise because of the high level of belief it has gained. It will then deserve to be told, come back to your Lord, well pleased and well pleasing unto him. Enter you then among my honoured slaves. As for a non-believing kafir soul, it will continue not to believe after death in spite of seeing all the wonders of Allah. So it will be deserving of punishment. As Allah says in Surah Al-An'am, but if they will return to the world, they would certainly revert to that which they were forbidden. We ask Allah for a sound, surrendering mind that understands its limitations and never objects to its creator. Woe to he objects. Would his objection repel destiny? He will only benefit shame. We seek refuge in Allah from that. And then Ibn al-Jawzi, in the middle of the book, talks about the way to purify the heart. He goes to a number of aspects in that regard. So he called it Sodlah al-Qalb, the reform of the heart. I've seen, being engrossed in studying fiqh and hadith, that this barely is sufficient in reformation of the heart, unless it is mixed with heart softening, or repartic, stories and having insight, another into the lives of the pious. see it as Salaf al-Saleh. So it's not just enough. Sometimes I think in our modern age, we think that simply studying the rules of Islam are what will purify your heart from its ills, from its lack of fear of God, its lack of sincerity, its lack of love. But simply just contemplating on that, in the al-Jawzi says, it will not purify your heart. Your heart is purified by looking into these stories of the pious, seeing how they lived, how they acted, and that has an impact on you. It's not to say leaving the study of fiqh and hadith, because his own life was completely immersed in the study of fiqh, but at the same time to balance it, to make sure you're not just only focused on that. He continues, as to knowledge of the halal only, that it has no major impact on softening of the heart. The heart's softened by mention, heart-melting narrations and stories of the pious, because they have acquired the objective of the hadith, having left the physicality of actions and having moved on to tasting their meanings. I'm only mentioning this after tasting the gulp and researching about it. I found that the drive of most of the hadith experts and students is in attaining hadiths with the shortest chains of narration and accumulating many parts of a hadith. And most scholars of fiqh are engrossed in polemics, arguing, and learning techniques that allow one to overpower his opponent. How can the heart soften with such things? On the contrary, the group of the righteous predecessors would seek a pious worship of Allah to look at his character and seek his guidance. Not to seek his ilm, because the objective of learning knowledge is to instill the sublime qualities in oneself and benefit from its guidance. Try to digest this fact. Blend your pursuit of the knowledge of fiqh and hadith with studying the lives of the pious predecessors and the ascetics, the zuhad, those people who did with very little in the world. This is more popular probably in previous times, and certainly in his time, where lots of people would literally give up the dunya to worship Allah. And so he says that this will continue to soften the heart. He said, I have compiled a book containing life accounts and attributes of many famous people and noblemen. I have compiled a book containing the tales and wisdoms of Hassan al-Basri, one on Sufyan al-Thawri, and these are the names I mentioned earlier. And so it's important maybe for us to research these names and these stories so that we can then benefit from their life stories. May Allah give us the ability to reach the goals. An action without knowledge is imperfect. Its example is like that of a co-pilot and captain, as the self is between them. It's hard to be controlled. With the serious attitude of both the co-pilot and the captain, the journey is undertaken easy. We seek Allah's protection from lassitude, from being lazy. And then there's a number of sections on the importance of sincerity, and how the foundation of inner goodness and acceptance in the divine court is sincerity. So he talks about the fruits, the thamarat of sincerity. He said, I wonder at he who pretends to be an abstainer, meaning from worldly pleasures and the like, in the hope of being near to the hearts of people while forgetting that their hearts are controlled by the one for whose sake he performs his deeds. And if he is pleased with his deeds and deems sincere, then he will draw the hearts of people to him. And if not, he will turn the hearts of people away from him. So it's here talking about those people who act piously in order for people to like them, in order to gain a reputation and a rank of people. If a person heeds to the hearts of mankind, whether they like him or not, then his intention is mixed with shirk, because he should only suffice with the one for whom he performs his deeds, meaning Allah. It is because sincerity necessitates that a person does not intend to attract the attention of the hearts of people to him, as such attention should happen not by seeking it, but rather by disliking it. This is because one should know that people will see the signs of his deeds in general, even if they do not see any of them, because hearts testify to the righteousness of the pious, even if they do not see his deeds. However, a person who intends to let people become aware of his deeds should understand that his deeds will be in vain, meaning they'll be of no use, because such deeds will neither be accepted by Allah nor people, whose hearts are made to turn away from him, causing his knowledge and life to be wasted. So here, Ibn al-Jawzi talks about how Allah is in control of people's hearts. So people may only incline to you or disincline to you by the will of Allah. So if a person is trying to act in a certain way so that people incline towards them, that will be fruitless if Allah turns people's hearts away from you. He then narrates from Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. He then finishes, thus a slave of Allah should fear Allah and turn to the one who can benefit him and pay no attention to the praise he may receive, as it shall inflict him and others with a trial. Another section on sincerity. He writes how a true person preserves the limits of al-hudud and sincerity of the ikhlas al-amal. Do not be fooled by a man's humming of supplications, du'a and adhkar and dhikr, and what you observe of him performing prayers, fasting, giving zakat, and self-isolation, uzlah. The true man is one who observes two things. He preserves the limits, meaning the limits of Allah's sharia, his law, and is sincere in his deed. How often have we seen a worshipper who exceeds the limits in backbiting and commits forbidden deeds on a whim? How often have we found a religious person, the purpose of whose deeds is not Allah? This illness fluctuates among people. A true person is one who observes the limits set by Allah, which are all his obligations, and one whose intentions, qasd, are proper, so that his words and deeds are sincerely for Allah, khalas, not aiming for people or their praise. A man may be humble to be called a zahid, ascetic. This is not the case in our time, I don't think, but in his time it was. He may be silent in order to be labelled God-fearing, a person who doesn't talk because they're trying to, not just because they're guarding their tongue, but they want people to say, oh, look, this person is very pious, he doesn't talk, unless it's about something good, but his intentions are pure, in a Jawzi beats here. And he may be disinterested in worldly pleasure, so that he may be known as a hermit, nasir. The mark of a sincere person, mukhlis, is to be among people in public as he is in solitude, khalwa, by himself. He may even feign smiling and happiness among people to avoid being called a zahid. Ibn Sirin, one of the early Muslims, used to laugh in the day, but when night came, it was as if he killed the townsfolk. Meaning that when he was with people, he was normal and happy. Okay, he wasn't walking around with a frown, or his neck arched, and looking all humble. But then when it came to night time, when everyone's asleep, maybe his family's asleep, that's when he turns to Allah, weeping over his mistakes, turning to Allah over his mistakes. And that's where his sadness is. His sadness is directed to Allah about himself. But with people, he's normal and happy. Know that the worshipped, meaning Allah, does not want associates, shirkah. The sincere one dedicates the deed to him alone, and the insincere one associates with him to gain people's praise. This will turn against him, because the hearts of people are in the hand of Allah, and Allah will turn them against him and not the other way around. Therefore, a successful person is one whose deeds are mostly hidden from people and sincerely for Allah. This is the one loved by people, even if he did not care for them, for they hate the insincere, even if his worship was evident. A person who has these attributes does not make short on pursuing knowledge, talab al-ilm, or virtues, for dhalim. He fills his time with as much good as he can, and his heart does not grow weary of its work until it is fully occupied with the truth. Which I think that's...
Yeah.
You could stop there, shall I?
Yeah. No worries.
Students, they want to go back to the lecture.
If anyone has got any questions to the Andrew.
Or to Sheikh and Sami more appropriately. Yeah. Questions of the heart.
No. No, you have a Sheikh today. Yeah. If there's no any question, inshallah, we can conclude by this today, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah khair, brother, inshallah. Next lecture, inshallah, we're going to be on the same time next week, inshallah.
Next week.
Jazakallah khair. Yeah.